Let this sink in for a minute, guys. The single biggest expense that you will incur in your lifetime is taxes. It's not housing, it's not vehicles, it's not healthcare, it's taxes. And our ability as tradesmen and skilled craftsmen to manage those taxes is huge in how we're going to be able to build wealth, have more financial freedom, so on and so forth. There is a lot out there on the internet about how the wealthiest people in the world don't pay taxes, large corporations don't pay taxes. But what does that mean for us as more of your average business owner? How do we maximize our tax savings and build wealth? I'm going to share some of the key lessons and truths that I've learned on this topic in this video. I hope you find it valuable. I've got five key points for you in this video. Point number one, starting a business is a huge tax advantage. I always dreamed of starting my own business, and if I would have listed out the top reasons that I had for starting my business, saving money on taxes was not one of those things. But as I've been in business for over almost a decade now, I have seen the huge advantages that you have as a business owner in regards to saving money on taxes. There's a myriad of reasons for that, and we're not going to get into all that in this video, but basically, the federal government designs the tax structure to incentivize entrepreneurship, to incentivize small businesses, because small business is what drives the economy. So in order to create more tax revenue, to create more economic growth, they have made it easier for those of us who run small businesses by incentivizing us. We have the ability to expense tons of things that we use for our business legally. Space in our home, vehicles, fuel, tools, office supplies, cell phones, insurance, the list goes on and on. Those can be expensed, whereas whenever you're an employee, you're paying taxes on your income first, and then you pay for those expenses. Whenever you own a business, those legitimate business expenses are a 100% write-off. You don't have to pay taxes on that money, and that's a huge advantage in tax savings. This is more basic stuff, but keep really good records. I have used QuickBooks for the last decade, and it's absolutely essential if you're gonna run a business to be able to line item all your expenses on your profit and loss so that you can properly report those expenses and save a lot of money on taxes. It's absolutely huge. Now, for my friends who are watching this, who are employees, especially in the skilled trades, there's some shady business that can go on. And if you're not educated on how taxes actually work, you can easily get taken advantage of. For the first part of my career, for a lot of the time, I was being paid as a 1099. Even though I was working as an employee, my employer was paying me with a 1099, which meant I was paying more taxes than I should have been. I was paying his share of the taxes for payroll also. As a self-employed person, even though I wasn't self-employed, and I also wasn't getting covered with workman's comp because I just didn't know any better in my teens and early 20s, I got taken advantage of. So make sure that if you are an employee, you're being paid as a W-2 and your employer is paying part of the taxes that they should be on you, and you're not taking the whole load. The next point that I want to make that has been absolutely huge for me is to get the correct company legal structure whenever you start your business. Now, whenever I started my business, I had to learn all of this stuff. Thankfully, I had a good CPA who helped walk me through it, but I had to choose what kind of company structure I wanted to have. You might have heard of LLCs, sole proprietorships, C-corps, S-corps. You've got to choose what structure you want, and that choice is going to make a huge difference on how much you pay in taxes down the road. Choosing what corporate structure you want to have for your business is going to depend a lot on where you want to go with your business, how you want to grow, how many employees you want to have, etc. It's great to sit down with somebody who knows what they're talking about and get an idea of what your goals are, and they'll be able to help you. A good CPA will be able to help you choose the right structure. Just some tips for myself running a small carpentry business. I chose to form an LLC and be classified as an S-corp, and that has been absolutely huge for me. All of us, when we start a small business, our goal is eventually that we're going to be making a nice profit in our business. And it's not as important in your early years in business because your expenses are so high, because you're buying all your tools, you're buying vehicles, you're paying down any debt, etc. But there's a point, I think, that I experienced, and I hope you experience, where you're going to hit a tipping point in your business and you're not going to have all those expenses anymore, and those expenses are going to drop down into your net profit. And at the end of the year, you're going to start to have a nice net profit. And unfortunately, that's going to be a big taxable line item that you're going to have to pay a lot of money to the government on if you don't handle it properly. And that's what this video is about. The beauty of being classified as an S corporation is that you, as the business owner, can pay yourself a standard salary based on the work that you're doing, and it has to be a reasonable salary, but then the rest of your profit you can take as a distribution. And the beauty of that is you don't have to pay payroll taxes on that, mainly Social Security and Medicaid, and that is about a 15% savings on that net profit. So once you're profitable and you're making a nice chunk of money, just that simple classification will save you 15% a year on your net profit. It's been huge for me. It's fit my business structure really well. I'm going to assume a lot of you are the same kind of mindset and business size. It's something you definitely want to get set up when you start out. It might be easy to not focus on these kinds of things when you're just starting a business because you're so engrossed in the grind and just getting jobs done and buying the next equipment and tools that you need. You don't have a big net profit at the end of the year, so it's you're not seeing how badly you need that. But once, just look at your profit and loss statement, look at all your expenses on tools, on vehicles and equipment. Now imagine if all that was paid off and your business was able to function on what you already have, what you've accumulated from your tools and vehicles, and all of that money that you have in those expenses could drop down to net profit. Now do the math on what you would be spending, paying if you're paying 35% to taxes on that. And just imagine if you could knock 15% of that off, drop that tax rate down to about 20%. If you're making a decent profit, it's huge in the long run. And building wealth is all about percentages. So it's very important to look into this. All right, guys, point number three, and this might be the single biggest money mistake or tax mistake that tradesmen and contractors make. And that is the idea that at the end of the year, I should spend my profit so that I don't have to pay more taxes. So let's say at the end of the year, I've got a nice, big, tidy lump sum in my net profit, and I see that I'm going to have to pay a decent amount of taxes on that. There's a notion that goes around with contractors that, oh, I should go out and spend all that money on business expenses or write-offs so that I don't have to pay the government their share of taxes on that. In the right context, that makes sense. If you have legitimate needs that are going to give you a return on investment in your business, by all means, spend that money, invest that money back into your business, and make more money from that investment. But what tends to happen is that tends to turn into a compulsive money decision where you're just blowing money for the sake of blowing money, and somehow we convince ourselves in our minds that we're doing the right thing so that we don't, because we're not paying more taxes then. And the worst part about this all is that a lot of CPAs give this kind of advice to their clients. And it's because the clients are just have no knowledge on finances. So whenever Bob the builder goes in, does his taxes, and he sees he has a big tax bill at the end of the year, he translates that in his mind to, my CPA is doing a bad job and I need a better CPA. Well, so what does the CPA do to Bob the builder who has no financial literacy? He says, oh, Bob, you've got a $100,000 net profit here. Why don't you spend some of that? That way your tax bill isn't so big and I can save you some money on taxes. And Bob the builder goes and spends the money. He thinks his CPA has done him a great service. Meanwhile, he is not building any wealth. I hope it makes sense how illogical that is to spend 100% of our money on something we don't need just so the government doesn't get their 20% or 35%, whatever it may be. It's really important to have discipline in this regard. I'd even recommend strategically making a list of the investments you need to make in your business, prioritize those, and strategically plan that throughout the year so that at the end of the year, you're not tempted or lured into making those compulsive spending decisions that ultimately aren't going to give you a return on investment on your money, and it's just going to be money wasted. It's more important than ever for tradesmen that we have got to be smart with our money, we've got to make wise investments, and we've got to have a strategy for building wealth into the future, because our bodies only can work for so long. It's really crucial to have good financial literacy. Okay, so we're on to point number four. What about our profits? What about that money that we actually made at the end of the year? And this really applies to employees or employers, small business owners. You're gonna have to decide how to most effectively handle your earnings. And there's really two ways that I look at that. Number one, how can I manage that money so I'm paying the least amount of taxes possible that makes sense? And two, how can I invest that money so that I can take advantage of compounding and grow that so that 20, 30, 40 years down the road, it's grown into something much larger than what I invest now. This video is going to hit differently for different people depending on where you're at in your financial journey, whether you're an employee, have a small business, whether you've got debt in your business, whether you've got personal debt. Years ago, my net profit I took and I put towards paying off debt, I didn't ever have much business debt, but I had a mortgage. So there were years where I just took my net profit and that went towards paying off my mortgage because I didn't want to have that burden in life. I preferred to have the freedom. At this point in my life, my primary concern is growing retirement accounts, investing that money so that it can compound. So whenever you have that net profit at the end of the year, start looking at, additionally, besides using your business to its fullest in the expenses that you can take, besides using your corporate structure so that you're not paying more taxes on that profit than you have to, we can also look at tax-deferred, tax-advantaged retirement accounts. When we look at how we're going to strategically allocate our money at the end of the year, we want to look at basically two time frames. Number one, what am I going to pay in taxes on that money right now? But then also number two, what am I going to pay in taxes on that money in retirement? There are different investment vehicles such as 401ks and Roth IRAs where you can either pay your taxes now, such as in a Roth, you pay your taxes now, put the money in, it can grow tax-free, and then in retirement, when you want to pull that money out, you don't have to pay taxes on it. Other accounts, like a standard 401k, you can make it, it's a tax-deferred account. So I can take my net profit, and I can put up to a certain amount directly into that 401k, and I don't have to pay any taxes on it right now. I can let it grow for the duration of my investment life, And then in retirement, when I want to pull that money out, I will have to pay taxes on it at that point. So there's strategy involved. One of the best ways it was explained to me is to look at your investments and have two different buckets. And in retirement, you want to have your taxable money that you can pull out and then your non-taxable money. And the reason that is an advantage is because you can strategically keep yourself under a certain tax bracket in retirement using tools that way. So you can go really deep into the weeds on this, but that's the basic core ideas on kind of how you can think about how you allocate that money. Personally, I use an HSA, a health savings account, as an investment vehicle, and that allows me to put $7,300 approximately per year into an account where not only do I not have to pay taxes on it, it can grow tax-free, and I can pull it out then tax-free in different ways also later on in retirement. It's a great vehicle. That's maybe my even top priority on what I fund first personally. And then I, as a small business owner, just being a one-man show, a solo 401k is a great investment vehicle. Also, where you can plug your profit into that and you don't have to pay any taxes on that now. And then it can grow for the duration of your investment career. And then you'll pull it out later down the road and pay taxes on it then. The great thing about a solo self-employed 401k is the reality for most of us as tradesmen, if you're running a business, you are going hard trying to grow your business, and you probably early on are not thinking about retirement too much. You're just trying to build up your tools, your equipment, and your business capital, and you're probably not plugging money into retirement and prioritizing it. At least that's how I was at first. The great thing about a solo 401k is it really allows you to catch up quickly and put a lot of money into that account. This year, you could put, like for my spouse and I, you can put $20,500 each into that as a standard, I don't know what they call it, just a standard deduction plug-in, whatever. Or there's a different way you can even structure these with SEP IRAs if you have a higher income where you can get up to $60,000. So that will allow you to catch up really quickly if you didn't get as much plugged into retirement earlier on. If you're fortunate enough to be able to max out those tax deferred accounts and still have money left over, you may want to look at just plugging that into a taxable brokerage account. So you're going to end up paying taxes on that money. And that's where having that advantage of the S-corp classification will save you 15% on the taxes you pay on that. But just plug that in to a taxable brokerage account. What I do personally, I just invest in index funds, Vanguard VTI, VTSAX. They're just index funds that follow the whole stock market, so they're pretty well diversified. You can set it and forget it. Don't get cute with it. And just let it grow and let that compounding take place. So everyone's going to be a little bit different, and your investment strategy completely changes depending on where you're at in your journey. What I do today was different than what I did 3 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, so on and so forth. So run your race. Don't get bogged down. Don't get overwhelmed because you feel like you're behind. Just keep plugging away each year, each day. Make the decisions that make sense for you and your family. Stay disciplined, but educate yourself. Which brings me to point number five. And this is huge. Have a good CPA. A good CPA can save you so much money in taxes, can just give you a lot of peace of mind and guidance on this journey. I've had the same CPA from the time I started my business. He helped me get my business structure chosen, helped educate me, and I always educate myself also. But you'll learn in this realm of taxes and corporate structures, you can spend all day for weeks studying these things and you're still not going to have the knowledge that a good CPA has. This is what they do all day, every day, and they're going to be able to give you some really good guidance. So having that CPA to lean on as you grow and develop in your, whether you're an employee or a small business owner, they're going to help you each step of the way to make the right choices to maximize your finances and be a good steward of those things. I do want to give a word of caution because I feel like this is really, really important and you could really screw up at this point if you're not careful. There is more money to be made in the financial services industry than you can imagine. And once you start to make some money, there are a lot of people who are going to show up at your doorstep wanting to offer you their services or sell you complex financial products. To sell you complex advisory services, maybe even not so complex advisory services, but services where, hey, I'll manage your retirement account. It's going to cost you 1%, 1.5%, 2% a year to do that. Study the math on compounding and you'll see that 1.5% or 2% adds up to a huge amount of money down the road. And most of the time, those financial advisors who are actively managing investments do not beat the market over the long haul. And if you study this, and I encourage you, do your own research, don't listen to me, but if you really study this, you'll find that if you can be disciplined and just put your money in an index fund that encompasses the whole total stock market and just not touch it, it will outperform 90% plus of active financial managers. So just keep that in mind. Be very careful. There are also complex insurance products, indexed universal life insurance. I went down that rabbit hole really deep because it offers a lot of promises to where you can grow your money in this plan and be able to pull out money in retirement that's not taxable and different things. I found at the end of the day, it was too complex to understand and there's a lot of hidden fees and stuff that goes into that where I think in the end, you're getting screwed. You got to be really careful whenever it sounds too good to be true. That greed reflex can take over really fast and you can make poor decisions. Greed and fear are your enemies whenever it comes to managing money. So keep that in mind. Educate yourself. Stay disciplined. Some people are going to need someone to manage their retirement accounts. If you don't feel like you're disciplined enough to do that, educated enough to do that, by all means, hire somebody you trust, a fiduciary. But for me personally, I'm pretty comfortable where I'm at. I've read a ton of books, done a ton of research, and my strategy has just been to buy indexed funds, set it and forget it, leave it alone, along with some bonds and things like that. If you want to hear more about investing strategy for tradesmen, I could do a video on that more in depth. Let me know in the comments if you want to see that. But I hope this video has helped you guys. It's tax time. We're all paying tax bills right now. And I kind of wanted just to throw this out there to guide those of you who are earlier on this journey a little bit, but then also just to give encouragement to those of you who are out there grinding in business to stay disciplined, to keep the vision that you have for your retirement, for your family at the end, and just make some smart choices. So hopefully this video was valuable to you. Give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you aren't subscribed already. Appreciate you watching. Let me know what you think in the comments, and if you've got any tips, I'm still learning every day, so let me know if you've got anything to share. Appreciate you watching. We'll see you in the next video.